Hello, everyone. What I will do is go through a brief presentation. I always preface this by saying I attempt to be brief, but I don't always succeed. So just, you know, wave me down saying, AK, you are just overtime. So I always start a synchronous presentation. What I'm going to talk about this morning or this afternoon is more on the synchronous side. I will say that I am an introvert, self-described introvert, so it's a little weird for an introvert to be talking about synchronous presentations, but here we are. When I start my presentations for class or for other virtual sessions, I have something like this so I can orient the people who are in the session, the things that they can and, you know, should maybe be doing during the session. Some sort of activity is good, just so that I know where all of you are standing and where you're at. So whether it's chat, whether it's, you know, thumbs up or like smiley faces or, you know, waving your hands in the camera or jumping into the chat, you know, it's all good. So this is my bootcamp edition for synchronous online sessions. My name is Apostolos Koutropoulos, briefly or loosely translated to Stubborn Apostle. Most people call me AK. I work for Applied Linguistics as the online program manager. I'm a lecturer in CHD Instructional Design, and I'm also emeritus from the Learning Design team. So even though I have left, I keep coming back because I love my colleagues. So for this session, some things in Zoom, use the chat feature. So feel free to send something in the chat. I keep an eye out on the chat and my second monitor, which is why I'm looking this way. I keep an eye on reactions, see how things are going. Some things when I'm talking about, when I'm actually lecturing, when I'm going too slow, if people wanted to just move on, then, you know, there's like a little, okay, go on, speed it up. There's an also a reaction for that. All right. So I'm going to stop talking for a moment. And I want you to introduce yourself. Usually I do this in the chat, but since we're relatively few people, we can jump into the text or the voice component of Zoom, and feel free to jump onto the mic, tell us what department you're from, and what animal are you feeling like this morning?
Well, I'll start. So my name is Lucilo. I'm in the College of Education and Human Development, specifically in the Special Ed Department. So the animal that describes me today will be the little happy puppy there, number 7.
Nice.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jacqueline. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Gerontology. And just because of the rain and cold, I'm from Brazil. I like the warmth. I'm going to go with number 9 today.
So do you expect us also to associate with an animal yet?
Yeah. What's your animal, Irene?
Yeah. So it's like such a great day. So yeah, associate with the warm, fuzzy kitten or cat, number 4.
Ooh. Angry cat.
Well, maybe.
And Rez, if you want to chime in.
Yes. Hi, everyone. I'm Rizarta, a member of Learning Design Services. In terms of animals, I don't know, maybe a combination of number 6 and number 8. I'm talking today, but I'm also still tired, so I don't know. Yep.
Totally understandable. So an activity like this, if you Google this, you'll find a lot of variety in the number of photos and the types and everything. So anyone who knows me knows that I'm a Star Trek fan. And if I happened to be in the class that I knew the vast majority of people were sci-fi fans, I'd find something relevant to that class to try to get them engaged in the beginning. Something like this kind of does a temperature check. in the face-to-face classroom, when you're walking in, you might see people kind of snoozing a bit, excited, talking. You don't necessarily see this in a synchronous classroom, or you might not get as many cues through the little Zoom windows if people have their cameras on. My personal policy is if you need to have your camera off, it's perfectly okay. Because when I'm presenting like this, I can't really see you. So whatever is most comfortable for you, and also your bandwidth, because there are times when the internet is just not cooperating and video does take up more bandwidth. So I leave it up to the students, but I really want to get a sense of where people are, so you can use the chat to for a larger class to have people check in. So that was my behind the curtain, what just happened there. All right, so for the agenda today, I have a few things prepared. KWL activity, which some of you might be familiar with. I'm going to talk a little bit about tools and practices, preparing for this, for doing online sessions, structuring that engagement. And then I said maybe a breakout activity. I don't think we have time, so I'll mention it, but we can talk about it at another time. All right, so just show of hands, whether physical or virtual, do people know what a KWL activity is? I know I gave away the answer on screen, but before this, had you ever heard of this before? See a thumbs up. All right, so it seems like KWL might be new to some folks. So it's an activity where you're priming your audience at the beginning. So you ask them, what do you know about something? And they can start chiming in. And what do they want to know about that something that will be the topic of the class? And the L at the end is a debrief at the end of the class. So what did you learn? So it's a good opportunity to get a temperature check, see what people know, see what the misconceptions might be, see what they're really interested in learning about, and then that way you can sort of address it in the class. Are people familiar with Google's Jamboard? Some yeses, some nos. Okay, so what I will do is I will copy this link and put it in the chat. A Jamboard is sort of like a virtual bulletin board. It's something that you can use to get students engaged, or your audience in general, if you're doing this for a conference. For demonstration purposes, if you haven't used this before, there are four boards here. So I've got, what do you know? What would you like to know? And then at the end, what did you learn? We'll forget about the what did you learn component for now. But what I would ask students to do, or conference participants, is to take a sticky note from the left. You can change the colors. And okay, what do I know about teaching online or teaching synchronously? So I will say something like, I need a tool like Zoom or Teams or Adobe. Oops. And I can pick the color that I want. I can do save. And as you'll notice, I just dropped a sticky note here. You can make it bigger or smaller. And as people participate in this Jamboard, and if you want to give it a try now, you can. I'll hold on a minute as you all experience this a bit. As this board gets populated with sticky notes, you can start moving them together in different categories to see if there are clusters of information that are coming up from your class. So if you see that a lot of people tend to know something about point X in the lecture that you're doing today, but not a lot in point Y, maybe you'll mention something about X and see where people are, but then move on to something like point Y when where people don't necessarily have a lot of previous knowledge of. And you can do the same thing in what would you like to know. You'll notice that you can still keep posting on that first Jamboard while I am on the second one. Yes, Adley, Jamboard will no longer be available after October 1st, 2024. I will be the last person on Jamboard while they're pulling the plug. I love this tool so much. There is another tool called Miro, but I'm not moving just yet. I'm still planning on using Jamboard for as much of 2024 as I can. Miro is a good tool too, but I've developed an attachment for Jamboard. All right, so let me go back to my list here.
But Miro is not free though, if I understand correctly.
I think there might be a free version, I think.
Yeah, because I did check, and the last time I checked, it seemed like they only allow like 3 boards and then that's it. So.
Oh yeah, I've come across that limit. I found creative ways around that, a little laborious, but I think that if you're using a tool like Miro a lot, it might be worth a subscription. We had something similar way back in the day, you know, back when wikis were a hot thing on campus and people were using wiki spaces a lot. There used to be some sort of institutional arrangement that you could have a UMB wiki space. So I don't know if Miro can do something like that. I don't want to speak for anyone, but yeah, I think that's a whole other workshop, creative workarounds for limited free tools. okay, so I want to talk a little bit about presentation skills. I think that a lot of people tend to be familiar with being in a physical classroom and having developed that expertise over the years, whether it's through official mentorship or through just keeping practice. So in the chat is usually where I do this because usually there's a lot more people. But without throwing anyone under the bus, can you tell me what is one thing that you've noticed about online, other people's online presentations and skills, whether they're good or bad? You know, what do you like? What do you not like? All right. So I will pick on Irene and say, Irene, when you've been in the audience, what is something that you like in presentations and what's something that you really don't like?
Okay. So what I dislike. So again, sometimes I guess, you know, we all, and like I definitely can relate to students. So we have a very, and it's a lot of science behind it. It's not just me. You know, we have pretty limited attention span. So again, and it also depends if I'm like listening to books, so like any podcasts just for information, this is one level. Again, if I'm sitting in something I really try to learn, it's something new to me, it's a very different knowledge, right? So, and it's a very different effort, you know, for me, you know, and for my, like for my brain. So I think again, sometimes it can be, it's not about the monotonous, but I'd really like to have something that allow me to reflect on what I just hear. And, you know, like reflect and kind of absorb it and have that tool or sound facility or anything to express it. So I'd like a stop kind of to get to. So I think like in many times, like this particular very important step for learning is missing. So again, sometimes pace is too fast for me. I can't really, you know, like people talk too fast, sometimes it's too slow, And like, yeah, sometimes it's just right. But I think, again, pace is not that important. But again, a stop and like give an audience, you know, the learners something so they can like really process the, you know, the knowledge they're getting. Because again, human brain is not just a box or container, you know, like it's, you know, it's not one way. It's not that linear. Yeah. Did I respond to your question?
Yes. And I see in the chat that Jacqueline wrote that people speak slower than in person. And I have a slide that's relating to this in a little while. They usually have notes right in front of them. I don't necessarily like the robotic aspect of reading from notes, but having your notes next to you is really helpful. Bad leaving not enough time for Q&A. I mean, it's not a one-way transmission. It's supposed to be a kind of back and forth. That's how we learn, right? Lusa says, wordy slides, presenters reading from slides. That is a pet peeve of mine too. And I have thoughts about that, a little tangential for now, but we can talk later about it, about how we can do this better. Right now I'm going to ask Irene, my co-presenter, to launch our poll here. So on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being bad and 10 being I'm awesome, how would you rate your own online presentation skills? And these are anonymous, so you can be perfectly honest. Cool. So between 5 and 7 and 7 to 10. So different people at different stages need slightly different things, I'm seeing this, but you are not seeing this. So here, let me share the results so you can also see it. So this is where we are as a class. This works a little better in a larger class, especially if you've got 30, 40, 50, 100 students on the Zoom call. You can kind of get to see where people are. But peppering these types of polls in the class, just kind of pausing, getting a sort of temperature check of where people are, mini quizzes. So if you put a question up and here's a multiple choice version of the answer, what do you think is the correct answer? You can get an immediate temperature check on students in the class at that point anonymously, so people can participate. And then if the answer is correct, you provide the corrective feedback as it's correct because, and this one was a bit of a challenge because, and so on. So it's an opportunity for that immediate feedback in the class. A little behind the curtain there. Practice makes perfect is a lesson that I learned a long time ago. When I was an MBA student here at UMass, I used to get the 5-pound laptop because that's how much they weighed back then. And I'd find that one of the few classrooms with a data projector in it, I'd go plug in the laptop and run my presentations through. This was for a face-to-face presentation in class. And our professors at the time said, you've got 20 minutes for this presentation. At the end of 20 minutes, boom, you're done. You're graded on what you presented. And that terrified me. But that got me to the point where I practiced my presentation to a point where I didn't need my notes as much, but they were helpful in case I needed to go off on a tangent or a fellow classmate asked me something. And those particular skills have come in handy now that I teach and when I do live sessions. So without outing anyone, am I the only one who talks to myself? Or are there other people around that talk to themselves as they process what they're doing and get a sense of how the presentation runs? I hope I'm not the only one. Now, if you don't want to say, just know that you're not alone if you talk to yourself. I do recordings on my computer screen just to get a sense of how things run. I use a tool like Camtasia, but there's also other tools like Echo360 and other screen recorders. I like speaking from the heart, but also have a plan for the presentation. So it's not impromptu. It's more like, here's my plan and here's how I become authentic. So I'm not just reading from the slides. You can also do this with peers. So if you have fellow professors or if students are watching this, fellow students, you can run your presentation through them and kind of get some peer feedback, which is also very useful. So I typically ask students to say in the chat, what is one area of opportunity that you see for yourself as something that you want to improve?
Like, and you can jump on
the
mic chat
if you want to say, or you can jump in the chat. Either works. And I will say kind of the meta element here is by asking for more participation, you're not just trying to engage students, but you're also giving yourself a bit of a break. So you can take a sip of water, stretch your legs, you know, do something other than talk. So an area of improvement that's been mentioned in the chat is having the presentation run smoother. So there are now a few gaps in transitioning. I call presenting a performative act. As I said earlier on in the presentation, I am an introvert. So when I get in front of a camera or in front of an audience, I get into my actor persona. So as part of that, I know my stuff, I'm presenting, but I've developed this sort of sliding into places where there could be gaps or sort of figuring out, okay, well, that didn't work. What's my plan B or plan C? So that I know there are gaps, but at least the audience might not feel that there's a gap. Being a little bit extra when you're virtual, this is something that some of my colleagues have come up with a suggestion. It's like being enthusiastic on camera. The camera kind of gobbles up your energy. And I don't know, how many people are familiar with Spinal Tap? Or this is Spinal Tap? It's a, if you like mockumentaries, so fake documentaries, it's a movie about a rock band called Spinal Tap. And they have this scene that talks about their, turning it up to 11, as Charles said in the chat, where their audio system doesn't just go to 10 like every other system, it goes up to 11. So a little reference to Spinal Tap in this slide. It's been recommended that people smile. As you can see, I'm not always smiling, but every so often I try to smile here and there when I think about what I'm presenting and how it makes me feel good and so on. And I try to not be Ben Stein in Ferris Bueller's Day Out. So you don't want to be that sort of monotone person. We are all geeks about what we do. We're really passionate about this stuff. So that kind of passion really comes out, or should be coming out, as we're talking to people. All right, preparation. I have a Mentimeter here. Are people familiar with Mentimeter? Okay, so a little tool demonstration for a moment. Nope, wrong slide. So I will post in the chat a Mentimeter. And this particular Mentimeter is a word cloud. And what you can do is enter phrases or adjectives or nouns, I tend to recommend that people use one word answers with word clouds. So what you notice about me, crocodiles, or weird. My answers are intentionally silly, but if you notice something about my presentation style, you can add it to the word cloud. If I hit submit, it goes to, the words go into the cloud to form the word cloud. Let me pause my sharing here. What you should be saying, AK did not prepare his Mentimeter ahead of time. AK is not prepared. But let me share my slide now that I've logged into Mentimeter. And what you'll be seeing is the types of words that the audience has submitted as part of this. So the more people you have, this word cloud actually becomes much more dense, and words that are coming up more frequently will be in bigger font and so on. This is another way of getting a sense of how people in the audience are receiving what's happening in the class at this moment. I'll say class or presentation. I've seen a lot of people use this for conference presentations as well. All right, some virtual classroom management tools. Just really quickly, for the security tool in Zoom, I like enabling the waiting room just in case somebody who's not in the class tries to join. Allowing participants to rename themselves. This has a lot of different uses. Both their preferred names can be visible, but also if you're undertaking role-playing activities in the class, people can rename them with the name of their character. As you set up your Zoom session, always, always, always select mute all upon entry to the room. That way, if there's somebody who's coming into the classroom as you're presenting, as the class is in session, you don't get blasted with a sound. And if you have a big class, consider asking a student to co-host with you. They can make sure that people's mics are off or muted. If there's feedback, they can keep an eye on the chat and kind of give you a virtual wave and saying, hey, AK, we have these three questions that popped up in the chat, you know, can we address those in the next break, and so on. A pro tip, share the application window, not your entire desktop. And also make sure to share computer audio if you're sharing something with audio. This way students are seeing just the window on the left and not the entirety of your desktop. Structuring engagement for the class. I assume that people are familiar with the difference between synchronous and asynchronous, right? I'm getting a few nods. Yeah, good. So during the height of COVID, when everyone went a little too much, a little bit extra on Zoom meetings, there was a joke that went around that said this meeting could have been an email. So figuring out what makes sense for synchronous and asynchronous is really important. Why am I here talking to you when I could have just recorded this and posted it in the class? The answer for that is I should be done with my presentation about now, as I see the timer on that screen. So I'm really going through really quickly so we can have a little bit of a Q&A. I like to plan. There is a lesson plan template that's available that I can share a link to. You don't need this, but it's good to have kind of a signpost. I think of my colleagues in K through 12 who do lesson plans. I don't know if they have forms like this, but I do know that I have seen lesson plans over the years, and they plan for everything. Planning makes perfect. There's also another expression that I've heard, the plan is nothing, but planning is everything. Various types of engagement tools. I will say that I am a big fan of a shared Google Doc, especially for a large class, so that you can have either a smaller subset of class or the entire class on the Google Doc and taking notes. You're collaboratively taking notes in the class, you're sharing resources, and that becomes a shared resource for the entire class. So for breakout rooms, I'm not really going to talk a lot. This might be a whole separate aspect, but I think one breakout room where you're leaving students in a small group by themselves to discuss a topic and come up with something is a good idea. It gives you as an instructor a bit of a break. So, and you can also do the virtual hopping around from room to room, kind of like what you do when you go from desk to desk and check in with students. Some good practices with breakout rooms: assign one person to take notes and maybe have one person who reports back. So the person who's taking notes is really focusing on the note-taking, and the reporter can focus on the discussion, moderation, reporting back, and using the shared notes from the class. I am not going to send you out to breakout rooms. We could do that another time. I always ask people how things went in the breakout room. There's always a debrief. So it's not just, okay, you're going to your breakout room. Okay, now we're back. I'm going to talk to you for a little while. It's important to have that debrief. And finally, I know you're all excited for me to stop talking. Attend other person's live sessions, especially when they're within your own department. I think there's a lot of cross-pollination. If you're really geeky and interested in other topics and how people run their sessions, I know that there are other online programs at UMass Boston. Maybe you're really interested in negotiation or in critical and creative thinking or some other topic. Reach out to a colleague and see what they're doing, and maybe you can get ideas and they can get ideas from you. Having some time to reflect, kind of like coaches in sports when they watch their game recordings afterwards and kind of analyze their performance. Think about what happened in class, what worked well, what didn't, what do you want to tweak, you know, what do you want to change for next time, and so on. And then at the end, what I would have asked you to do is at the end of the session, you know, what did you learn? This could be something like an exit ticket. So it can be done at the end of a live session for class, or it can be done as part of a, you know, take 5 minutes after you leave to tell me about what you learned, and it's part of your participation grade. All right. With that, I'll ask for Q&A. And because I talked about multiple screens and looking here and also looking there, this is sort of what my setup looks like. The only thing that I actually bought was the keyboard and the computer. Everything else is just found. So the main monitor that I have was a hand-me-down from a friend who moved overseas. The TV, also the TV on this side, also works as a monitor, an HDMI monitor. Family friends passed away and their kids were giving away their stuff, and I used it as an extra monitor. So you don't have to go out and buy new stuff to make something like this happen, but at least two monitors are really helpful when you're doing a live session. That is what I had, the really abbreviated bootcamp version of the presentation. I realized I've just been talking a lot, so I'm going to take a break, have a little coffee, and see where everyone's at. You know, what do you think?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, perfectly. Yeah. Happy luncheon.
You know, this is something I've never done before. It's not a virtual background. It really is U-Haul. and I'm sitting at a table or a chair with a view of the water with my rice bowl, and I have my headphones in into my MacBook Air or MacBook Pro, and I can see just fine. And if you can hear me, I'm talking at a level where no, I'm not disturbing anyone. So that's terrific. Thank you. What I'm grappling with right now with a online synchronous class is engaging the students better. And I'm finding I'm working in Beacon Flex. So I have some students. Can you all hear me now? You all look frozen.
We hear you.
No, we're good. Oh, good. We're good. You're good.
Good. Smooth. And good. And so I have a few students in the classroom, and the majority of the students are at home. And this may be an unintended consequence of Beacon Flex, that a group of students, given the choice, would really rather be taking an online synchronous class as opposed to having Beacon Flex be something they use from time to time, as opposed to all the time. But and I've taught online, and somehow it's easier for me when everybody is online, but when it's partly in the classroom. But I'm just trying to get conversation going. One of the things I've tried to do is project Zoom on the screen, on the big screen, so that everyone, so that the what I see right now would be on the screen, so that everybody's head is live, and I ask students to turn the cameras on. But I'm just having a hard time getting discussions going. Wonder if any I'd love some advice or some ideas.
Yeah, the high flex, or that aspect of flex, is a bit of a challenge. Part of it, this is just my view from having experienced different modalities of distance ed over the years, is that as an instructor, you're physically present. So you are working the environment that you're in. But at the same time, there's that overhead where you're kind of mindful of what's happening in the online space. And that's a little difficult to try to navigate just as one person. About 15, 20 years ago, before current technologies, we had something similar to Beacon Flex connecting to physical classrooms. Boston and Lowell were the ones that were my case when I was a student. So we connected our Japanese class from Boston to a Japanese class in Lowell, and Lowell had a teaching assistant on that end to assist students with what was happening there, whereas the instructor was in Boston and working the room in Boston and sort of periodically getting connected with Lowell to answer questions and do stuff like that. Unless students in the physical classroom are also on Zoom at the same time, it's kind of hard to have those two populations collaborate. So having the people in the class kind of work in smaller groups, and then having the people in the virtual space do the breakout room or work with each other, and then everyone comes together to share, is much more of a solution to this particular issue. But it is tough. I'd have to kind of sit down and kind of think of, you know, your class and what's happening and what's the topic and what kind of activities can we build that leverage these spaces.
So additional challenge is, yeah, that like the students in the classroom need to be together, and students online need to be together, and like on any given, like, you know, live class, that groups, you know, can you know, like mix, you know, you don't have like fixed groups. Otherwise it creates echoes. It's a lot of also audio problems. So that's another challenge again of, again, students in the class are difficult to hear, like if like you're on Zoom and vice versa. I mean, not vice versa, mostly if you're in the classroom. No, if you're on Zoom, you have a problem to hearing someone in the classroom, and that also creates like audio problems. That's another challenge. So, but I want to hear out and first from Lusa, and then from Jacqueline. So, yep.
So I actually have a question rather than a comment on that topic, though. Is that okay?
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So my question is actually more about the online discussion. Those of us who have taught online courses before, I'm sure that we have used online discussion forum one way or the other. So I kind of want to hear, not necessarily just from the e-learning team or AK, but more for the rest of the people who have taught online courses. Like, when you utilize online discussion, like how do you structure it, and what kind of expectations do you set when you actually grade your students' participation in the online discussion?
It really depends on the class. It really depends also on the size of the class, and also again what kind of like learners we have, like graduate versus undergraduate, and also undergraduate the level, like 200 versus I don't know, like seniors and juniors. So one way of doing that, it's really you want to post the question that requires them to rely on the information, they learned either from your lecture or from the reading. So it needs to be a pretty complicated, not a simple question that like will like really generate some, serious response intellectual from your students, right? So this is one. Second, you really want kind of the student to provide you with the authentic, response. And by that, that's a tool in Blackboard, for example, that allows you, to block all other students' answers. So you really kind of, unless they post themselves, though, that really kind of, push students, to think, creatively about the posted question. So it's a tricky thing. So like, again, it depends on the specific situation and like, your better understanding, as a teacher of your learners. So sometimes, again, you can put students in groups and give them the choice. So what they want to respond to, then, you really kind of put them in charge, and giving students the voice and the choice can help. For example, you can do it in groups, but also you can do it like putting students like and post like two or three questions, the weekly. And then, you put students in groups and they respond to one, or, you also, and then they share their responses so other students can share that. So, for example, it really works better if the class has large enrollment, because then, all the discussion and responses, they're much more cohesive, instead of, like you create a smaller group with more like intimate and more, so that will be another strategy. So, if the students are mature enough as learners, you can ask students or two students to be your discussion forum hosts for a specific week. So, which means again, they have to, or even create their own question. So they can pose their own question, you can meet with the host of that week and discuss them and kind of approve, validate or not. Again, there are various ways, you can do that if you trust, your students come up with something challenging and, something challenging and you know, a deep question, right? So, and then these two students, they will be, that can be an assignment, that can become an assignment where they, you know, two students, one can be facilitator and kind of like really watch the discussion board. So they're in charge for a specific week. And another student can come up, you know, with the summary of all the responses and present it, you know, on the, on like, you know, from their group. So I don't know, does it help? You know, it depends on, again, like we're happy to meet with you and talk about other strategies. So yeah, yeah, I talk too much.
Yeah, so I've used online discussion for a long time already because I've taught online quite a bit. So I think I have kind of tweaked it in one way or the other, you know, based on sometimes feedback from students too. So I expect students to actually participate in the forum, you know, during the week. And mm-hmm. I do close the forum, you know, on Sunday, you know, by whatever time, just because the following week we'll start, we usually start a different topic. So kind of irrelevant if we keep things open and people go in whenever they want. So during the week, then I don't set limit on when they need to submit their first polls. But I do tell them the expectation is you need to submit an initial polls, then you will have to have at least three responses. And then I learned that because I work with graduate students, so they all work full time and, you know, always have busy schedule and stuff. Then I found out sometimes most of the students will wait till Sunday night and make it more like an assignment. And then clearly it's not the type of discussion that I would expect them because it's mm-hmm. more like a chore rather than really discuss the topic. So then I tweak it in a way that, okay, you need to have three discussion, three responses, but the three responses cannot be submitted on the same day, you know, because that mm-hmm. will push them at least come back another time, you know? So I don't expect them to do it every day, but at least come back a second time so that you can kind of see what's there. And so I kind of get 50-50 type of response. So some students loved it because they said that it's very structured, you know, they get to really discuss versus I have some complain that, you know, having, you know, three responses on different days is too much because we're busy, you know, that kind of stuff. So that's why I kind of want to, I may not get the, you know, the right answer to this, but kind of want to just see, you know, what's out there. How do people actually structure it? Are there other ways that I can consider, you know, because everyone I talk with, yeah, so I didn't really get that. Yeah.
I have some ideas, and I'll come back to them, but since it's 12:56, I want to give the microphone to Jacqueline to ask a question or make a comment, and then go back into, forums as needed.
Thank you. I'll be short. And I have a question. I have several, but I'll focus on one right now. This is my first time teaching online and my first time teaching undergrad. So probably not the best combo. My issue has been with group assignments. I think it's important that students learn how to work in groups. You know, I think it's an important task in life. You're going to work in teams, but students have been really complaining about being on a synchronous online class and having a group assignment. Because if you are in an in-person class, you would meet before class or after class. You like catch up with each other during break. But that's, for them, has been more difficult during online class. I've been trying to give them some alternatives, but I don't know if you have any best practices on group assignments or if it's best to avoid them.
I love group assignments. I love them so much that that's what my dissertation was on. that said, looking at both my experience as a student over the years and looking at the research that I looked at, group assignments can be challenging. Is your class synchronous or asynchronous?
It's synchronous.
Okay. Multiple times a week, like Monday, Wednesday, Friday?
Just one time a week.
Okay. So there are two sort of tactics just right out of the gate that I would employ. One tactic is to give them some time during the synchronous session and say, we're going to be doing this first. Then I'm going to be giving you 30 minutes, 45 minutes, however much time you want to get into your groups and really have this focus time. Like, you've set up this chunk of time that you'll be in class, so you'll be working on this. And then we're going to come back together at this time to continue and debrief. Now, they might not do it during that time, but you're giving them the time to do it. You're allowing for that space. The other tactic that I use and that I often recommend comes from actually one of my old professors when I was an MBA student. Joan Ton, she was an organizational psychologist, I believe, and she had us doing group projects. And what she required us to do was once a week, we were going to meet outside of class with our group to work on our project. And there was a team leader that we could decide amongst ourselves who that was. There was a secretary who kept meeting minutes and action items and all that stuff. And then there's all the stuff that we all worked on together. And we needed to submit meeting minutes, I think, at the end of every week, showing what we did as a team. I will say that when I was a student and I experienced this the first time, I was like, oh my God, we have to meet in person outside of class on a Saturday? Come on. But at the end of the semester, I had connected and gelled with those people. And I still think of them, you know, 20 years later. Yeah, students are going to hem and haw about this, but I found it to be a very valuable learning experience. And having that deliverable of meeting minutes every week that somebody could audit, like somebody like a professor could audit, was something that helped us keep on track. I mean, there's obviously other things that you can do and different considerations to keep in mind, but those are my two go-to just right from the start.
Great, helpful suggestions. Thank you.
Go ahead, Charles. Yep.
I can jump in that while I'm having a hard time with classroom discussions, group work is something that has worked well with my online classes. So I've only taught online synchronous. I'm getting ready to teach online asynchronous in the spring. I teach, and my best experiences have been in the College of Management Business School, where I, but with what I've been doing that works really well is the students are in groups that are given a case study to analyze and talk about. And it's tied into the topic we've been of the week generally. And that in our 3-hour class, I'll open with the first bit of the class as my opening talk about the whatever the topic is to sort of set the stage. I try not to go on too long with that or structure it in a way where there's a I'm lucky that there are a lot of little videos that I can find so that if I talk for 10 or 15 minutes, I can intersperse a video so that I'll give an example that Michael Porter has a lot to say about business. He's like the guru of strategy. And we have all these readings about Michael Porter. Well, because he's such a big deal guy, he's all these YouTube videos where he's, and so I can say, you can read about Michael Porter or you can watch the guy and live down on the red line from Harvard. So that I'll show a little clip to break it up. Anyway, the students then go into the groups and I've changed the format a lot because we have ChatGPT. And it exists, and I don't want to police that. I don't even want to compete with it. So I asked the students to do a PowerPoint presentation. Rather, in the olden days, like a year ago, you'd turn in a written thing of your case analysis. Now they have to do the same thing as a PowerPoint. And each student has a group of slides. and we go over, and because it's business school, it's perfectly valid and maybe even more important for me to teach PowerPoint skills of no more than 10 slides, no more than 20 minutes. The smallest font is 30, it's called the 10, 20, 30, anyway, with the idea. And then the students come out of the groups and present their presentations to each other. And I post them on a Google site as a gallery. So at the end, everyone can look at each other's show and we can then in the next session critique it together and say, what was the strong point? What was not so strong? I'm going out on a limb. I have no idea what's going to happen, but my son in high school, he has to do what's called a pakucha or something like that. It's a Japanese technique where you have 20 seconds to talk about a slide and it automatically shifts. The format is 20 slides for 20 seconds. And for someone in high school Spanish, that's great, because then you're talking about what's on your slide and you do the next one. And I'm going to try it with one of the cases and we're going to see what happens, because the students have a tendency to read their slides, put way too much words and read their slides. So anyway, I'm playing around with that, but I find the group side it works. That's working for me, because there's a deliverable and we watch everybody sees everyone. So it's sort of fun. And a little bit of it is competition. Like the students, like they know their show, everyone's going to see their show. So they want the best, slideshow.
It's interesting mentioned that. Yes. So it's actually the great format, one of the best been developed for like ed tech. It's Japanese.
yeah.
So it's really the format that pushes you. It's like for this lightning presentation, it's a good skill for kids to develop, again, presentation skills, what they put on the slide, and also like really polish their public speaking. So anyone who will mention that, like for their future employers, that they like, familiar and like present this, they will be hired. So I'm so happy you do that.
Yeah. Well, thank you. No, and I find that it does lead to a good analysis. Like and because it's live, I quiz them on the spot. In other words, and everyone has to participate, and it's sort of, they know that I can ask any of the group members to answer. I try to mix it up so that I'm asking different people. So. Something else that is coming down the pike, Irene, I sent the software link to Zach, but Brandeis has developed some software that will allow you to monitor your Zoom session and specifically tell you how much you're talking, how much students are talking, how much you're calling on men versus women. An analytic. And I haven't set it up yet because, I'm just too big. But anyway, I'll also forward that link to you. I sent it to Zach, and I know that he's looked at it a bit. But I think the idea that having the system give us feedback on how we're doing with our Zoom sessions will be a really valuable thing too.
Absolutely. Good point.
Yeah. And thanks for the word cloud. I've been trying to figure out, I've been looking at the word cloud in Word, and it's all too cumbersome, and it has some, and looks like what you provided is exactly, I just want to be able to say, how's everybody doing today? Put in your word of the day, and, or later say, what did you really, like, what one word summarizes today's class, and whatever that word, anyway. So thank you. And Irene, thank you for your note. I'll be getting in touch with you to...
Okay, yeah. Yeah, we'll figure something out, yeah.
Well, what's good, actually, is I feel like there's a real structure with what we've... I've worked with Irene in the past for the others, and she helped me think about hybrid and online synchronous. And so I'm at a place where I've gotten pretty good at finding lots of materials where instead of just the reading, I have videos and podcasts. And especially for the students who are driving, I hear over and over again, thank you for that podcast. Cause then I could put it on in the car. I could do my reading while I'm, you know, my reading or my, you know, my, I'm doing class prep while I'm driving to campus. And it's generally the guy who's, or the woman who's written the text being interviewed by someone. So it's every bit as good as reading the text in my mind as a way of conveying information. So, but thank you for this session. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks. So we'll be in touch, Charles. Yeah. Have a good day.